Good morning, dear students. I hope everyone is doing well. Take care of yourself from the coronavirus infection. Take all the measures which are necessary. So today we'll be having a class on neurocysticercosis and other CNS parasitic infections. I will start with some of the CNS parasitic infections and then go to neurocysticercosis. So how exactly the CNS gets infected will be my first few minutes, and then we'll classify the parasitic infections that essentially goes for central nervous system, and then we'll come to neurocysticercosis and extra intestinal manifestations of tinea solium. Now, parasitic infections of the CNS is otherwise known as neuroparasitosis, and we know that the CNS is a highly perfused organ and it amounts to 22% of the body weight and receives around 5 to 20% of cardiac output, so it is highly perfused. And where we get the parasitic infection of the CNS compared to viral infections, bacterial infections, it is much, much rare. However, some of the infections are very of public health conscience, so it cannot be neglected. So who are the people who get CNS parasitic infections? Usually people living in poverty and low social status who are exposed to many kind of parasites, and specifically people living in tropical areas get this CNS parasitic infections. And like for any CNS infections, CNS parasitosis also the clinical manifestations comes with headache, epilepsy, decline, mental functions, and so on and so forth. So this is just a classifications to recapitulate that we in the parasites have a protozoa. One is MEB and one is flagellates, that is Giardia, Leishmaniasis, and Trypanosomiasis. They fall into this group. But the apical complexa, which we call sometimes as sporozoa also, where it is Plasmodium species, Toxoplasma gondii, and many of the intestinal coccidia like Cryptosporidium, and then we have ciliates. So this is MEB Entamoeba histolytica, and then you can have a free living MEB, and then mastigo fora, you have flagellates, it could be in the blood, it could be in the urogenital systems. And in the apical complexa, we have Plasmodium, Cryptosporidium, and Toxoplasma. If you look into the helminth again, it can be broadly classified into nematode helminths and platyhelminths. Nematode helminths are the long cylindrical worm, whereas platyhelminths are flat. They could be intestinal and tissue infections. So we have cystodes, where Tinea sagenata, Tinea solium, and other things come. They have a tape-like segmented structure. Trematode is a leaf-like unsegmented structure. And nematodes are elongated and cylindrical unsegmented. So this you know from your earlier classes. Now let us look what is tissue tropism. Why we say it's a neuroparasitosis, this is a hepatotropic virus, it is a, what do we call as renal tropism. So how come the tissue tropism comes, and then we'll see what is CNS tropism. Tissue tropism is basically when a particular organism is able to specifically interact with the cells, or it orient itself towards a given stimulus to that particular tissue. So it could be hepatotropic, it could be neurotropic, it could be any tropism. Now, is the tissue tropism is the same in all cases? Not necessarily. It has a different degrees, a different label based on what kind of receptors the particular tissue has. So it depends on the host, the tissue, and the cell. Now, the tissue tropism can change during the course of infection. So it's not like that every hepatotropic virus enters into body is necessarily going to cause any kind of hepatic disorder, but it can change during course of infection. So initially it might not, and later on it can. Like if you give an example of acute toxoplasmosis, It essentially infects the gut and then causes some kind of lymphadenopathy and other intestinal diseases. But when it goes to the chronic stage, it produces the brain invasion. So now, looking at the tissue tropism, we can classify the neurotropic microorganisms. So let us have some examples. Like neurotropic bacteria can affect the meninges, it can affect the ventricular system, and it can affect the brain parenchyma. So we know that the meningitis is mostly caused by the Streptococcus pneumoniae, H. influenzae, Neisseria meningitidis, and then leads to the monocytogens, Escherichia coli, in case of neonatal meningitis, and many organisms are there. So this is a schematic presentation of your organism. Whereas Mycobacterium tuberculosis goes to the ventricular and it can produce CNS tuberculosis, or we can have tubercular meningitis. On parenchyma also you can have treponema causing neurosyphilis, nocardiospasis, and Listeria monocytogens. Similarly, if you look into the neurotrophic viruses, there are certain viruses which causes meningitis, like we have enterovirus, which is the commonest cause of meningitis, and then you can have West Nile, Japanese encephalitis, as well as mumps and measles. So this can go to the meninges. In the ventricular system, only Jessie virus has been found to be very tropic towards the ventricular system. And if you look into the brain parenchyma, there is a number of viruses, starting from herpes, CMV, and enteroviruses, HIV, and whatnot. You have a whole plethora of neurotropic viruses. If you look into the fungi, we have Cryptococcus neoformans, which is very well known as causes of chronic meningitis, not acute meningitis or not aseptic meningitis. And the parenchyma can be secondarily involved with Candida albicans, Aspergillus, Zygomycetes, and many other fungi. If you come to the parasites, many of them are not, some of them are primarily affecting the CNS, and some of them are secondary. We'll come to that discussion a little later. But if you look in the Toxoplasma gondii, it produces Toxoplasma encephalitis. Neisseria fowleri, it free living amoeba, which produces primary amoebic meningoencephalitis. Trinia, Trypanosoma brucei, produces sleeping sickness, and Tinea solium produces cysticercosis, which we'll talk. And then meninges, if you have, there are very uncommon organisms, angiostrongylitis cantonensis and Trichinella spiralis, can sometimes cause parasitic meningitis, or we call it as eosinophilic meningitis. Now, before, how do these pathogens do enter? And we know from your class of physiology, there is a blood-brain barrier. How it started? So this is called, we can say, road to brain, or lane to brain, or way to brain. So there was a study long time back. It was done by Paul Ehrlich, and when he was looking for a treatment towards African trypanosomiasis. So what he used a trypan blue, and he wanted to say that whether it had got a chemotherapeutic effect or not. And then what he observed was that some of them are getting colored and some of them are not getting colored. So that gave the particular concept that there is some kind of barrier is existing within the, from the blood and brain, and he named it as blood-brain barrier. The blood-brain barrier is a selective diffusion metal which is separates blood from the CNS, and it forms tight junctions and interconnected with endothelial cells. Besides blood-brain barrier, we can have blood-CSF barrier also, and it constituted of a monolayer of epithelial cells. So we have a blood-brain barrier and a blood-CSF barrier. So essentially, if you look into the blood-brain barrier, what you see is this is your blood endothelial cells. This is pericyte, which is there is tight junction here, and then pericyte is covering the whole area, and the astrocytes are present, and there is a control of endothelial cells, and transcytosis is a method of entering of microbial cells, certain microbial pathogens by pericyte. So this is what is the schematic diagram of a blood-brain barrier. And if we can just highlight, so we can have a blood-brain barrier for blood side and brain, and blood and CSF barrier. So you have choroid plexus, cerebral capillary endothelium, astrocytes are here, tight junctions are here. So in that way, the blood-brain barrier is there. So making it much more simpler, then we have blood-brain barrier, then we have blood-CSF barrier. So how do the organism, any organism, enter into the central nervous system? There are two ways. One, the barrier function which maintains a homeostasis can be disrupted by certain wounds, by a catheter, any surgery being done, or arthropod bite and host conditions. That leads to inflammation and dysfunction of a host gene product implicated in the barrier function. Secondly, barrier can also be crossed actively by the direct action of microbial gene products and can go to the cell. So, what are the various mechanisms by which the microorganisms enter into the CNS systems? It could be a blood-brain barrier breakdown due to certain reason, and then the infection can get in. Then there we can call as Trojan horse, where the some phagocytes or neutrophils facilitate invasion, and this is what is the pathogen. It is being carried by this and can get entered into this. Sometimes we call parasitosis because it can enter through certain mechanism, and that is called from the side, and that's why it is called parasitosis. And sometimes it can be transcytosis. So these are the various mechanisms by which we can see that the organisms can enter. Let us have some examples. Now the routes of entry into the CNS could be through retrograde transport along the axons, and that's the best example for this is rabies virus. Similarly, if you look into the transendothelial entry within the CSF compartment, there are so many organisms, mostly all which are causing meningitis, even angiostrongylitis cantamensis, which causes eosinophilic meningitis, enteroviruses, measles and chikungunya, which also causes meningitis. So, transendothelial entry is a major cause for meningitis. Whereas for rabies and herpes and other, they are retrograde. Yes. Then paracellular entry, as I said, it is entering from this, you can have certain other organisms, and transendothelial entry, Leptospirosis gondii and Tinea solium, and infected leukocyte Trojan horse, as I said, Toxoplasma gondii, Cryptococcus neoformans, and so on and so forth. So, CNS entry by infected leukocytes, transendothelial entry into the blood-brain barrier, paracellular entry, transendothelial entry, and retrograde transport exons. So, this is how it enters. Now, let us come to parasitic infection of the central nervous system, which is your topic for today's class. Now, the protozoal infection of CNS can be primarily classified into two. That one is primary CNS parasitic protozoa, that means they are neurotrophic. Whereas there are certain parasites which can migrate and can cause certain CNS infections. So, this is the basic fundamental differences you have to remember. In Entamoeba histolytica is also MEB, but here it is free living MEB. So, Acanthamoeba species and Balamuthia mandrillaris are another species which produces granulomatous amoebic encephalitis. That means the chronic inflammatory infections and little insidious in insidious onset. If you look into the Negleria fowleri, it is primary amoeba meningoencephalitis. It is very very acute and it can cause severe death. So these are the free-living amoeba. When we get exposed to certain aquatic system, we get this kind of infections and it can cause to the primary meningoencephalitis. Plasmodium falciparum, though it produces malaria, there are certain strains there. Essentially, they want to be in the CNS system and cause cerebral malaria. So we can call it as a primary. And similarly, Toxoplasma gondii, though it produces initially the intestinal lesions, but in the chronic stage, it can cause to neurotoxoplasmosis, and more so in case of HIV-infected individuals and transplant recipients and other immunocompromised patients who cannot mount a response against the infection and can land up with neurotoxoplasmosis. The trypanosomes, which is essentially causes CNS infections and cardiac infections, but which is not there in India, but it produces sleeping sickness, we call African sleeping sickness, composed by gambies, Trypanosoma brucei gambies and rodentiensis, and Trypanosoma brucei, which is seen in Latin America, this is seen in Africa, so there are cerebral Chagas disease. So we can classify protozoal infection into this. Some of the examples that free-living MEB infections are essentially postmortem diagnosis. we cannot have antemortem diagnosis, and once the brain, and the death is quite fast in these two infections, and we can see the pathogens and we can really diagnose. Cerebral malaria, we know that falciparum, plasmodium falciparum is the only which produces cerebral malaria, though there are reports of plasmodium vivax also producing cerebral malaria, and we see the changes in the brain as well as in the retina, and we can see the hemorrhages. Similarly, toxoplasma encephalitis, acute, it infects the God cell, and pathology is related to that, whereas chronic toxoplasmosis, it is a hallmark in an individual who has count less CD4 positive cell count less than 200, and mostly it is a hallmark that if anybody has got an encephalitis with a CD4 count of less than 200, we should think about toxoplasma encephalitis. Then African sleeping sickness, this is the trypanosome, just like looks like a promastigote of Leishmania, and this produces sleeping sickness and mostly affects the CNS, skin and skeletal system, which is mostly present in Latin America and in African countries. Now let us look at the helminths. If you look into the helminthi causing parasitic infections, we can broadly classify them as the cystoid, trematode and nematode. Now if you ask me a question that what exactly is the primary causes of helminth, then I will put angiostrongyloides cantonensis, which causes eosinophilic meningitis, and rest of them, echinococcus granulosus is a secondary helminthic conditions, tinea solium, which we will be talking in cysticercosis, is again you can put it overlapping between primary and secondary, and these are also secondary causes. So if you classify them as the helminth as primary CNS parasitic pathogens, we will find tinea solium is the most typographical error. Tinea solium is the most common causes neurocysticercosis. Then, of course, trichinella spiralis, angiostrongyloides cantonensis cause neuroangiostrongyliosis or eosinophilic meningitis. And these three, angiostrongyloides cantonensis, angiostrongyloides costarri sensis, and Grathostomus meningeorum, these are basically seen in Southeast Asia because of their food habits, and eosinophilic meningitis is an entity over there which we hardly see in our subcontinent. So you must have heard about Toxocara canis and Toxocara cattei, which produces visceral larva migrans, and that sometime can migrate to central nervous system and causes neurotoxocariasis. Did some migrating, but if the VLM lands up in CNS, we can call that okay, it can primarily can cause, because this is going in a it can land up in any kind of viscera. The helminth which causes secondary CNS parasitic pathogens are echinococcus granulosus, which essentially involves lungs and liver, but it can go to through circulations. It can go to the cerebrum and can cause cerebral cystic echinococcosis. It can go to the spinal cord, can cause spinal echinococcosis. And then there are a few other uncommon organisms which has been found in the brain. So these are the various parasitic infections we see. And eosinophilic meningitis, as I told you, this is mostly in Southeast Asia, Central America partly, and Toxocara canis. And another roundworm infections can be seen in certain particular geographical area. Okay. Now let us look into the second part, which is the neurocysticercosis. Before going to neurocysticercosis, I have divided into two parts, 2A and 2B. 2A is essentially I will talk about tinea solium, how it produces tineasis. And part 2B will be what cysticercosis is and how the cysticercosis gets to neural system and produces the neurocysticercosis. To recapitulate, we know that tinea solium and tinea saginata are the two cystoids which produces a disease called tineasis when it only involves the intestinal system. Tinea solium has got hooklets and rostellum and suckers, and here we don't see any kind of hooklets in tinea saginata. That's how it is differentiated in the adult worm, and they are all tapeworms. Tinea solium causes two diseases, one is tineasis and human cysticercosis, whereas Tinea saginata causes tineasis essentially in human being, but it can cause bovine cysticercosis. Now let us look at tineasis. Tineasis is the intestinal infections caused by Tinea solium as well as Tinea saginata. The tinea is basically used for the structure it has, like a ribbon. It has got scolex and proglottids, which I have already explained. And Tinea saginata is called beep tapeworm, and Tinea solium is called pock tapeworm. Adult tapeworms of both species occurs only in humans, so we see those tineases because humans become the definitive host. Whereas in case of beep tapeworm, it is the cattle; in case of pock tapeworm, it is the pig, which are the intermediate host. Sometime this conventional this particular life cycle can have little aberration. A Tinea solium larva can cause disease in human, meaning thereby the human can act as an unusual intermediate host. So whenever human becomes an unusual intermediate host, the larva of Tinea solium cause the disease, that is what will be cysticercosis. So if you, how do we differentiate Tinea solium and Tinea saginata? It causes infection in both. These are the intermediate host. But if you look into the Tinea solium, the two infections which humans get is tineasis, that is the intestinal, and cysticercosis, that is the extra-intestinal manifestations. Whereas Tinea saginata, due to consumption of beef or something, you can only have tineasis but no cysticercosis. So this is a class. How to know that an individual is suffering from Tinea solium or Tinea saginata? It's very difficult to see the segments and other things, but what you can basically gather some information clinical setting, that gravid segments which are expelled passively in chains is complained by the patient. So he says that I am passing certain segments, and they are usually in 5 to 6, so they are in cluster. But when the individual is having Tinea saginata infection, he will say that I just find one segments which is coming in the stool. So we can say that he is having a Tinea saginata infection and Tinea solium infection. So the X which is seen in this Tinea are not clearly differentiated. It cannot be differentiated, no difference in the egg morphology, but we should just know that what is oncosphere, embryophore, just for the diagnosis, which will be discussing little later. Now what is cysticercus? Cysticercus is a bladder and a tail. This is something like a bladder and a tail. So that grows within the human body because of the larval growth of the Tinea solium, and then when it is there in the different organs, we call it as cysticercosis. Many people use the word cysticercosis cellulosi. It's a larva of Tinea solium. Name is given due to its tendency to develop in the connective tissue, so it is cellulosi. Whereas cysticercus bovis is the larva of Tinea saginata. So this is how a cysticercus cellulosi will be seen when the larval growth of Tinea solium occurs. So they form like a bladder like structure, and then it is present at different parts of the body. Now why we are talking so much about Tinea saginata and Tinea solium? Because this Tinea infections are fundamentally, what happens is we have close approximations to the cattle as well as to the pig, as far as because of animal husbandry. So this relationship between humans and their livestock is basically making the disease little more common. The other relationship is the definitive host consumes. Who is the definitive host? Human being. It consumes the meat of the intermediate host like beef or pork, right? So because of this, the Tinea saginata and Tinea solium are more or less present in the people who are closely associated with animal husbandry or are associated with these livestock. Now, so we know that Tinea solium causes two diseases, tineasis and cysticercosis. Now this cysticercosis, which can go to any connective tissues of the human body, when it goes to the CNS system, we call it a neurocysticercosis. So the two different forms of infection which can be seen due to Tinea solium is human tineasis and human cysticercosis. Okay, it's a very the Tinea solium produces cysticercosis is very prevalent in poor communities, and these are the various areas where we have seen like these are the countries where it is present more commonly. And if you look into the India, there is a big study from SGPGI Lucknow. They have gone to the field areas and they found throughout the country that these are the various areas which are infected with Tinea solium infections at a different magnitude or different prevalence. So what happens, this is your Tinea solium is the intermediate host. It comes in contact with a human excreta, and then subsequently the egg penetrates, the oncosphere is released, and then it goes to the hepatic portal vein and enter the general circulation. So during the process, the POC develops, eggs migrate to the skeletal cardiac muscles where they form cysticercosis, that is the larval form. So when the larval form are present in the muscles of these intermediate host, we call it as Porcine cysticercosis. Now what happens, here the individual is eating and it might not develop at this moment, but it is taking an infected muscle and the cycle remains. He might not get any kind of cysticercosis infection, but he is releasing eggs, and this is one way of having tineasis. Sometimes this is how the tineasis goes, like because you are eating infected meat, but somehow you are passing the eggs and then it is the cycle is remaining. But sometimes what happens, accidentally the larval stage of Tinea solium in humans produces cysticercosis. Accidentally sometimes the eggs are consumed by the human, which is usually not, through contaminated drinking water or contaminated food, eggs. So remember, the cysticercosis starts with consumption of the egg, not by the meat of infected intermediate host. I repeat, the cysticercosis is caused by ingesting the egg in a contaminated drinking water and contaminated food, or could be due to external autoinfections with the contaminated fingers which has the eggs, and internal autoinfections due to regurgitation of prokaryotes in the stomach and the eggs are released. So only when the eggs are released and subsequently goes to the human being, then the eggs will produce larval stage within the human being and the cysticercosis is developed. Okay, so we can see here that once you are taking the meat, it is just simply going and produces tineasis, but sometime when the eggs comes and then the egg is ingested, the cysticercosis might develop in the human being. So this is, we can call human cysticercosis, and if this animal, we can call it as porcine cysticercosis. So what human cysticercosis is? Cysticercosis is a prevalent worldwide, caused by the larval stage of Tinea solium, not Tinea saginata. It considered as a biological marker for social and economic development or the status of a particular country or a state or a region. It commonly affects the subcutaneous tissues, central nervous system, ocular system and skeletal muscles. The skin lesion assists as a marker for the diagnosis of asymptomatic neurocysticercosis in endemic areas. So many people develop skin lesions and that says whether he is suffering from this. So you take a biopsy and you look for the organism, and if you find it is there, then you can say it is a normal cysticercosis. And neurocysticercosis is subsequently goes from here and can cause central nervous system infection. So neurocysticercosis is the most common parasitic infection of the central nervous system if you take the parasitic or neuroparasitic infections. The most common neurocysticercosis again is the most common cause of epilepsy which people encounter in neurology OPD, like grand mal, petit mal, epilepsy due to various other reasons, like any kind of brain lesions. But the infective lesions, near 28.4% of active epilepsy has been found through CT scan that this is mostly due to neurocystic sarcosis and the brain has typical ring enhancing lesion. So neurocystic sarcosis can involve central nervous system, brain parenchyma, ventricle, basal system, sulci, gyri and whatnot. Neurocystic sarcosis can be again divided into parenchymal and non-parenchymal. The oncosphere can locate and encyst in the brain parenchyma, mostly in the corticomedullary areas, also in the cerebrum, and this intraparenchymal cyst gets calcified subsequently and you can have a lesion like this in the postmortem. Non-parenchymal cyst, the cyst grows in the subarachnoid space or in the ventricles and that blocks the flow of the cerebrospinal fluid, and hydrocephalus is often a complication of non-parenchymal cysticercosis. Spinal cord and extramedullary intermedullary is less, it is 1 to 5%, but you can also have spinal cord involvement. So how do neurocysticercosis are presented in the brain or in the CNS system? The larval death causes inflammatory reactions and results perifocal edema, which consecutively damages the parenchyma. And when it damages, it produces four different kind of scenario. It could be a cystic and vesicular. It could be gradually degenerating and becomes colloid in histopathological examinations. You can have nodular and then it gets fibrosed and becomes fibrous nodule. So these are the four variety people often see in histopathological or in the clinical examination to examine some of the lesions which are present. So cystic and vesicular stage is basically a viable cyst and it is composed, well defined, and is fluid filled membrane which contains colon. So cystic lesions means it's viable. Then it starts degenerating and becomes colloid and granular. It corresponds to the parasite necrosis and associated inflammatory process. And the tissue surrounding with foamy macrophages and neutrophils is same. When it becomes nodular, the fibrosis develops with time and progressively occupies the entire lesion and becomes a nodule. And finally, it gets fibrosed and measured in partial dystrophic and calcifications. So these are the four different types of. So one is cystic, secondly degenerating colloid, one is nodular, and then fibrous nodule. So if you look into the CT, that can be only diagnosed in this. Like if you look into the figure 2, it is a viable cyst in MRI. Cyst with perilesional contrast enhancement here, enhancing lesion, and 5, the calcifications, you see it has been calcified. So viable and non-viable can be differentiated, and then it can be graded whether it is nodular or not. Now, how exactly the immunopathogenesis of neurocysticus occur? Now the living parasite is the viable cyst, where it contains the viable cyst, usually induces no or minimal immune response. Living parasites mask themselves with the host immunoglobulins and through certain Fc receptors of the immunoglobulin and somehow tries to grow. But over a period of time, the viable cyst cannot combat the immunological interactions and it will die in due course of time. When the outer wall starts degenerating and induces intense infiltrations that are associated with pathology and granuloma progression. So this dead or dying parasites increases the inflammations and subsequently the clinical manifestations does occur. In the mice model it has been found that there are certain glycoprotein layers when tegument can be recognized by the brain tissues and they have become the stimulus for having immunological reactions. So the humoral immune response, which can seen within a month of post-infections and can persist for 3 months, and mainly IgG response is there. If you look into the different subtypes of IgG, that IgG2, 2A, 2B, IgG1, In the serum CSF in saliva, we suggest that the infection is of long durations and the response is basically talking about the person had an exposure to these infections. And if he has a multiple cysts, the humoral immune response will be much more compared to a single cyst in the brain. Then subsequently, people have started using the mice model about the cellular immune response. And inflammatory response has been found that there is early granuloma formations. And during this early granuloma formation, there are T helper 1 response with abundant neutrophils, macrophages and many T cell subsets. Whereas in case of late granuloma formation, it is a mixed reaction of T helper 1 and T helper 2, and specifically interleukin 4 of T helper 2 to give a granulomatous reaction. So we can say that the Th1 response when the parasite is intact and it is little more viable, whereas the mixture of Th1 and Th2 when the parasite destruction starts. So both, and these Th1 and Th2 parasite maintains an equilibrium with the host immune response in early infections, but as the time passes, the Th2 response gets polarized and then you can have granulomatous reaction. Now, based on this kind of interactions and immunopathological background, we can see a different kind of clinical spectrum. The clinical spectrum again has certain depends, it's multifactorial. It depends on where exactly the cyst is localized, the various stages of the cyst, how many number of cysts are there in that particular organ or in the, like the brain, in the parenchymal or non-parenchymal, and what is the host immune response. So these are the multifactorial conditions or factors that makes the clinical spectrum to manifest. Let us see what are the various spectrum of cysticercosis. You can have a subcutaneous cysticercosis right here or here or here or here. And the cyst can also be in the muscles, and once it is in the muscle, you have a muscular pain, weakness and pseudohypertrophy. So you can have subcutaneous cysticercosis, is most common, muscles is little less. Then when it passes to the eye, there are many cases of ophthalmic cysticercosis, which is every day, I mean you can see one or two cases in case of RP center, this, like many cases of intraocular and extraocular cysticercosis has been reported. And intraocular it leads to proptosis, double vision, loss of vision. And extraocular cyst resembles slow growing tumor. So you can have, you can see ocular cysticercosis here. The parenchymal disease is basically when it is affecting the brain and various corticomedullary or cerebral, this part of the brain. It can lead to headache, epilepsy, weakness, cognitive decline and so on and so forth. So based on which part of the parenchyma has been involved, we can get various neurological symptoms. In case of non-parenchymal, as I said before, that it can have hydrocephalus and there are certain other lesions in the ventricles. Now, how the symptoms of human cysticercosis? So, skeletal system, I have said that it will have muscular pain and other things. So, you can see the subcutaneous nodule, right? And you can see the starry eyes appearances here. This is a postmortem showing different kind of cysts, and these are the certain hemorrhages. And here also a CT scan showing cysticercosis. Now, neurocysticercosis is not an easy diagnosis. Though we know that we have histopathological evidence, we have CT evidence, but we have to prove that whether it is a definitive one or a probable one. So for whether it has to be definitive or probable, there is a various algorithm has been developed. I don't think you have to go to all these algorithms. This is more of a interest of a neurologist. So if you have absolute criterion, then you have histological demonstration, cyst is solid in CT and MRI, and fundoscopy examination. So this is absolute. Then if you have absolute, and then you have measure and manner criteria. In the measure, there are suggestive reasons from the radiological investigations. Then you can have certain serum antibody by certain blood techniques. and resolution by giving the treatment. And then if it is minor, like compatibilism, positive CSF allergies. So if you make in combinations, permutation and combinations, then you can have the definitive or probable. So you have absolute, major and minor. So if you have a patient's one absolute criterion, like any of these three, in those who have two major plus one minor, then we can say it's a definitive diagnosis. So definitive one absolute from here, two major, one minor, and epidemiology, where the patient is coming from and what kind of epidemiological relationship it has with the livestock or exposure and so on and so forth. And probable could be one major, two minor, one major, one minor, epidemiology, three minor, and so on and so forth. So this is a clinical diagnosis of making definitive and probable diagnosis. Specifically, when you are diagnosing a case and it's a medical legal case, you have to be 100% sure that you are a definitive or a probable one. So imaging is the major stay, in fact. So you can see the same picture again, viable cells and calcification. Okay, so you see it's a very big giant cyst, cysticercus encephalitis. You can see all are dotted like a starry eye, this thing, and we call it a cysticercosis encephalitis. We don't say only neurocysticercosis. And there will be basal subarachnoid and ventricular appendicitis and so on and so forth. So cysticercal is because of the inflammation of brain parenchyma due to toxic reaction of cysticercal antigens, and which are released after the death of the cyst, either spontaneously or due to cysticercal therapy. So it can respond to some of the treatment also, and it might not respond and can have an adverse reactions. So how exactly encephalitis, cysticercal encephalitis looks like? You see the different kind of cyst. It's amazing that an individual surviving this kind of infection. Now how do we diagnose? As I said, tinnitus is an intestinal disease caused by tinea solium or tinea sarginata. So we have X and proglottid. So X can be seen in the stool examination, and proglottid, that the patient complains that okay, I have a cluster of segments. You can see tinea solium if it is a single and passing with lot of exertion, or what I mean to say, like lot of pain, then we can have tinea solium. Now the cysticercosis, I don't want to reinforce again and again. X-ray, CT scan and MRI as a major mainstay. As for your this thing, then we can have tissue biopsy to reveal the different forms of like viable or colloidal or fibrous and nodular. And then you have certain serological assays. So serology, sometimes anti-cysticercal antibodies will be able, or cysticercal antigen can be used, that can be looked for, and then you can say whether the patient is what exactly is the titer, and then accordingly you can make an interpretation. An ELISA crude partially purified antigen has been used, and it has shown a 75% sensitivity. Now polymerase chain reaction has also been used to see the different kind of genotypes present in that, and different kind of strain of tinea solium which can cause the neurocysticercosis. And the pathology is showing the postmortem analysis of brain section is showing clearly the certain hemorrhages and the cyst. Now how do we treat? It's a treatable disease. So what needs is you need to diagnose early, and then the patient will be all right. So that's what, in case of a neurocysticercosis, if the patient has certain epileptic manifestations and it gives a certain epidemiological clue that you have to suspect a neurocysticercosis, and the radiological investigation suffices it. So praziquantel, though it's a little more toxic drug, a dose of 50 milligram per kg per day for 2 weeks can be used, and it's usually a single regimen, and it can, in certain cases, it can be used. But the most convenient drug which is being used is albendazole, is a 15 milligram per kg per day, and initial length of therapy could be given for a period of 1 month, later reduced to 15 days or 1 week. In 60 to 80% of parenchymal blastocysts are killed after standard course of treatment. So albendazole is a very effective therapy. However, the neurologists think a little different way when the patient is having neurocystic sarcosis and having epilepsy and certain inflammatory condition associated with this. So they have developed certain recommendations which is being followed internationally. If you have 1 to 2 viable parenchymal cystic sarcosis, then albendazole for 10 to 14 days can be given. Along with, if the patient is epilepsy, then you can add on to some of the anti-epileptic measures, and steroids often added in the anti-inflammatory conditions. If it is more than 2 viable, then you add albendazole plus praziquantel, and the combinations are drug given for 10 to 14 days. And again, presence of seizures will allow to administer any epileptic, taking the totality of the patient's condition. Calcified, there is no treatment necessary. If seizures, you treat it. Anti-inflammatory, also not this thing, and not military. Cystic circle encephalitis, which is like showing the starry kind of this thing, and many infection, antiparasitic infections has no role. So you have to treat the seizure and this. So this kind of combinations are taken during the examination of the patients, and when the patient is admitted, and then you have to take a call for it. So there are some consensus guidelines has been given. If it is parenchymal, I mean, like again, if you know mild to moderate encephalitis, albendazole plus steroids, which has to be high dose, and this. So this is more of a neurological, and I'm not going into the detail. And then a combination, permutation combinations can be given depending on hydrocephalus and so on and so forth. So the treatment again depends on the nature of the cyst, whether it is viable, whether the enhancing lesion. So then you are going to do with both combination of like antiparasitic as well as steroids and other drugs. Finally, if the treatment is besides conservative management, if certain intervention has to be done by a neurosurgeon because of the location of the cyst, like it is in the fourth ventricle, surgical removal is the only way, right? And the single genesis and surgical removal can be done. Surgical therapy mainly restricted to placement of ventricular shunts for hydrocephalus secondary to neurocystic sarcosis. So in case of any kind of ventricular shunts or any cyst which cannot be really treated so well with the conservative management, surgery is the next option. So thank you very much. So what, within another 5 minutes I will tell you. Then when we look about the CNS parasitic infections, first you see that which are the parasites which are primarily neurotrophic parasites, classify them into protozoal and helminthic. Second, some of these parasites can be due to neurotrophic because of the secondary migration through hematogenous routes. So you can put them as the secondary CNS infections. And there are parasites which can be mostly seen in patients who are immunosuppressed, like toxoplasma. So you can classify like that. And when you are coming to the CNS parasitic infections, some of them are happening in our country, and some of them are happening in at other parts of the world. And finally, in the cystic sarcosis, you have to make a clear distinction that the teniasis is a cycle which is happening within the intermediate and definitive host, and there is no involvement of any extraintestinal manifestations, that is teniasis, which can be caused by both tinea solium and tinea saginata. But cystic sarcosis can be caused in humans if the tinea solium egg is taken without eating any pork or anything, without taking any non-vegetarian diet. Also it can happen due to contaminated food and water by ingestion of the Tinea-Psyllium eggs. Secondly, by external auto-infections. If your nails and everything like contaminated, you are not maintaining good hygiene, then it can go through externally. And internal retrograde infections can happen due to reverse vaginalysis, and the eggs can come out from the mature segments of the proglottids and it can come to the circulation and can cause the disease. Now the cysticercosis essentially in the beginning will be manifested as subcutaneous nodules. It can affect the muscles, and if it becomes a hematogenous spread, it can go to any place. And mostly the orbital cysticercosis is a common manifestation, and then finally the most fatal or the most dreaded is neurocysticercosis, which we have talked about. Thank you so much, and take care of yourselves and be safe and be healthy. God bless you all.